Hey, so my name is Brad Newberg. I'm with the Open Web Advocacy Team here with my good friend and colleague, Dion Almayer from the Mozilla Foundation.
Good to be here, Brad. Yeah. Good to be here back at I.O. It's always fun.
So you're working on this amazing project, Bespin. And why don't you tell us a bit about what it is, what you're doing?
Sure. So Bespin is a project that came out when my partner in crime, Ben Galbraith, we founded Ajaxian.com together. And we've kind of been talking up all these web technologies all the time, right? And we wanted to see, let's actually build something that's on these new HTML5 fancy technologies, and like, what would that world be like? Mm-hmm. We care passionately about developers, so what would be a cool developer tool? So we created this Mozilla Developer Tools Lab. So luckily we've got the word lab in there, mm-hmm. so it means we can kind of experiment and play around. And we want to take an app that people aren't used to on the web. So we thought, how about an editor, a coding experience for developers? So that's one of those things, especially developers can be a bit cranky sometimes, like, there's no, I'm never giving up my Emacs, and like, that'll never work on the web.
Exactly.
So it's like, what would the world be like? Could we build something that was ready?
Yeah.
So that's really what Bespin is. It's this like social coding experience using all of like the shiny technologies, because mm-hmm. We've seen a few like little code editors on the web, and they never would like scale, and you'd get little beach balls on large files, and it never quite felt right. So frankly, we wanted to see like what could be done there.
Mm-hmm. So let's say I'm a coder and I've got VI. What are some really compelling things that made me sort of let that go and say, let me check out Bespin and see what's going on there?
Yeah, so the first thing would be us implementing a VI mode, probably.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Step one.
Yeah, and we want to have VI mode, Emacs mode, all that stuff.
WordPerfect bindings?
WordPerfect. Yeah. So get that little sheet that you there can put on the top of the computer. But seriously, though, we actually do want to get like that kind of world in. And also, we're not trying to like take people away from their editor so much. It's kind of a different world. It's complementary to your IDE or experience in some way. So what we're trying to focus on, rather than build yet another IDE with a million features, we're trying to pinpoint some really fun, compelling features for web developers specifically, right? So with Bespin, you've got this really fast social editor that allows you to very easily collaborate on code. Right. So earlier today, you guys announced...
Collaborate on code? I thought you were supposed to just sit in a closet.
I know, exactly.
By yourself.
Exactly, yeah. It's like no one can see.
Yeah.
But you just announced Google Wave, which is all about this real-time collaboration. Mm-hmm. We can use those APIs. We already have our own, but we're happy to integrate with other things. So now, say you're doing a code review. Instead of like, here's my code, click, goes off to code review, patch land, mm-hmm. then later on it comes back. It's like, hey, Brad, do you want to check out the code with me?
Yeah.
Real time, right?
Yeah.
And you can, there's a chat window built in. So you're chatting on it, and it's associated with the code,
nice.
With the file and where that code is. So say a month later, someone comes on and is like, who did this function? You can just select the function and see, oh, Dion and Brad did it together, and here's what they talked about right
there.
Yeah. Right? So like really associate this stuff.
Nice.
Go back in time. Again, there's this Playback API in Wave. We had a similar notion where you're looking at the source code, and you can just go back in time. It shows you commits for that file, tags,
nice.
And you just kind of go back and see what happened. Replaying the events themselves. We're working on a project together. I go off to the doctor and come back. What's Brad been doing?
Right.
Just like hit replay, right?
You can come blame the
exactly,
guy.
Yeah. Yeah. Instead of like staring at diffs from commits, like what's happening, one of the features I really like is I want a world where like we're working on something and you just clobber a function that I'm in too, and I see that, alert, Brad's just in here. I want to commit quickly, so you have to do the merge.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like all these little things that we can do now, we're kind of aware of what's going on.
Yeah.
So it's fun stuff.
So there's this notion, I think a lot of developers out there get this idea of programming for the web. We like to call it's programming for the 1997 version of the web.
Yeah.
You had the really nice experience of programming for the 2009 version of the web. I know you've been able to use all these modern facilities, modern aspects of JavaScript. How has that experience been?
Yeah, it's been awesome, man. It's like taking off the shackles, right?
Uh-huh.
And like that's one of the reasons we wanted to do a developer-y thing is because developers haven't come to us saying, I need this in IE6.
So just to be clear, that's also true. So currently Bespin is only supported on modern browsers.
Yes.
Specifically Firefox at this point.
Firefox, Safari,
well.
There's a few weird things with Chrome and Canvas,
yeah.
but most of it works.
So you're not shackled by sort of backwards compatibility.
Exactly.
So what are some of those, what has been one of the nicest limitations that you're free of now?
So the debugging experience has totally changed. It's amazing how close the modern browsers actually are. Mm-hmm. Right? So like in the past, you're always doing it, and there's like these weird bugs in IE6 and this, that, and the other, and you spend all your time on that. Even though there's still subtle differences, mm-hmm. Like I'll give you one, we do a lot of stuff with the WebWorker API, right? Mm-hmm. But what browsers is that in first? Mm-hmm. So we created a facade that if you've got workers, great. If not, try and use Gears.
Yeah.
If not, we'll just do set interval and just make the code actually run, yeah. But it's not going to be great. But then within the browser, Safari doesn't support import scripts,
okay.
Part of the WebWorker API. Mm-hmm. So we implement that in the facade. So you're Mr. Shim, you understand this world. And so we did the same thing for workers. So you can just go ahead and use the same worker API. And there's all these like subtle little things with workers, like we do real-time syntax analysis. And so we have JS lint built in, for example.
That's great.
So as you're typing, it's like, tells you the error right there.
That's worker.
And it's running in a worker.
So it doesn't block the execution of the
exactly.
Script.
Otherwise, you'd be typing and it'd be frozen. So we've got a whole bunch of these like smart agents that we can kick off to workers. Mm-hmm. But then we started to see the CPU usage go like crazy, right? Because we're not restricted to this like single thread in the main UI thread in the browser. We can start firing stuff off.
Yeah, yeah.
But now that's using up all of the browser and is counteractive. So there's no notion of yield and stuff like that, which I really want now.
Yeah. Or
and
sleep.
Sleep, exactly, yield, And so what we have to do is we have like different slicings where we go through and monitor how many workers. And so this code, this facade is all open source in Bespin.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if people are interested in like doing worker stuff, it's there. And we want to break it off into its own open source project. So being able to use workers has given us a huge win for us, because we can start doing all these things that we'd never even be able to do before.
You mentioned something I want to highlight that most people don't expect. The sort of the modern browsers, Safari, Chrome, Firefox, are actually very similar to each other.
Yeah.
And I heard a statistic that I didn't realize from someone recently. Firefox 2 turned over to Firefox 3 within 2 months. 50% of the audience flipped over.
Yeah.
I just learned about this recently.
Yeah, that's cool.
So these browsers are revving faster than people expect. So you can use these newer features faster than you'd expect.
Yeah, and there's kind of this like weird chicken and egg situation, right? Where it's like, if we don't go and build apps using Canvas and all these things, then why is it worth switching from IE6?
Exactly, it's a tricky.
But like, we've got to get it out and push. Yeah. I know it's really hard for consumer apps and stuff, but like, I'm trying to like get it there and then give people a reason to upgrade.
Mm-hmm. Right, right.
But then like, with the fast JavaScript, that alone was a huge thing. Mm-hmm. Canvas, we even saw that a few interesting things, like we got this huge speed bump from when I was testing WebKit nightly. One day it just like instantly was faster.
Interesting.
And we're like, well, what changed? Well, what actually turned out was the Canvas implementation, they made an adjustment to the algorithm where it only blit the changes on the canvas instead of painting all the time.
So it had a dirty flag?
Yeah, exactly. And so in an editor, that's like heaven, because most of the time you're typing and all you need to do is add in the text.
Right.
And so again, we're benefiting from all these browsers kind of innovating.
Yeah, exactly.
And we saw this big bump for nothing.
Yeah.
And we also did a lot of techniques like, we didn't think that having like one huge canvas full screen would scale. Like, we didn't think it'd perform. And that turned out not to be a bottleneck at all. We now have multiple canvases, actually. Mm-hmm. Like, we have this Pie menu, Quicksilver thing that animates on. It's actually on its own on top.
You just do a Z-index.
And again, we were like, is this going to, like, be weird? Yeah. Not at all. It performs fantastically.
Interesting.
The funny story about bottlenecks is...
They're never where you expect.
Exactly. We made a big mistake in that a day before we shipped Bespin, we have this syntax highlighter. So, obviously, you're going through, and we just... As you do, we grabbed an open source one that's kind of in the model of you write a bunch of code into a text area, hit something, it shows you like pretty HTML.
Right,
it's one of those guys, right? Like using a blog or something. So we took that code and started to use it. But for us, we're painting again and again. Mm-hmm. And so every time we paint that line, we're doing syntax analysis to do the highlighting.
Nice.
And we profile it, and it was doing like 500 regex per line.
Yeah.
And we're painting every 10 milliseconds or whatever. So we're doing thousands of regular expressions.
Was it a compiled regex? Did you reuse your regex object?
We would reuse the regex object, but it was like different ones going on. It's just like just an immense, every 10 milliseconds, thousands of regexes, right?
Yeah.
And so we're like, this is nuts. We got to skip that. And so we wrote our own state-based, state machine, very simple syntax highlighter. And like, we have our unit tests, and it's like, here's the one that we had at first, and here's our new one, and it's like thousands times faster.
Hmm.
And then we go check it out again, and it turns out it barely made a difference to the responsiveness at all, because we were so worried that we had all this JavaScript code that's doing all the canvas stuff, that that would be the bottleneck. JavaScript wasn't the bottleneck at all. It was all the blitting it to the screen was the bottleneck.
Right, interesting. I know. So it's always... Do your measurements first, and then actually do your optimization.
Exactly, yeah. So that again kind of hit home that JavaScript isn't the bottleneck that it used to be.
No, especially when we start using the newer things like Canvas, SVG, blitting to the screen. You know, that's always the bottleneck. The DOM is the bottleneck, so generally.
Yeah. But yeah, it's been kind of fun to ignore the DOM sometimes too. Uh-huh. And like, that's, again, like the Canvas API is so small that being able to just have
that. You know, or a t-shirt, I'm ignoring the DOM.
Yeah.
Totally. What are you going to do about it?
It's interesting. Yeah. And it's kind of funny, like, at one version we're using jQuery, which is a fantastic library, but we realized it wasn't doing anything for us because
it's all about DOM.
It's a DSL for the DOM.
Yeah.
So, fun things have come out of it. Like, we've started to play around with this Thunderhead mm-hmm. UI toolkit. Because, okay, you got Canvas, you got this thing to draw things, but how do you put these components? There's no component hierarchy. And it's been really fun to kind of play around with that. And we reuse CSS, and we now have implemented like a bunch of this CSS3 stuff. Yeah. So the developer just uses even like -webkit -transform or whatever, and it works.
Nice.
And we've implemented it in Canvas.
Right, you're parsing it in.
Yeah. And what's so cool is that, like, you're like, man, I wish we had this CSS3 feature. We just do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And implement it.
Take the future in your own hands.
Yeah, it's cool. But
we're almost out of time, unfortunately. There's way more interesting stuff here than we can talk about in 8 minutes. But if people want to learn more and want to get involved, I know you've been really great about pulling people in, new contributions. How do they get started? Where do they go?
Yeah, so the main site for Bespin is bespin.mozilla.com. That's where you'll go to kind of see the flagship product. Mm-hmm. But there's actually different pieces. So if you like the editor, there's an editor component. It's all open source.
It's
you can reuse it. Exactly. You can use the servers. Everything is there available. We have a wiki on wiki.mozilla.org/labs/Bespin. Has all of the information on IRC channel, mailing list, and we'd love you to come help contribute to the platform.
So just in the last 5 seconds, what's been one really cool external contribution, and who's the contributor that you really liked and appreciated?
Yeah, so this guy, Julian, this is actually kind of pretty awesome. So as an experiment, you're an old open source guy, so you know, it's like, how do you get contributors, right?
It's not easy.
Not easy. So I did a little experiment just to kind of goofing around where I was about to add a feature, and instead of writing the code, I built a fairly detailed spec, but not too rigid, mm-hmm. and got the graphics all ready and all that stuff. And I said, this is a 50-point feature. So I emailed the people out there, I was like, anyone who can do this, you get 50 points. They meant nothing, right, at this time. And then a day later, this
Guinness
guy...
Well, Guinness is 25 points. So.
Yeah, exactly. He thinks that he's German, so I definitely think he expects a beer.
Right.
But like literally a day or two later, this Julian guy from Germany came along and just implemented. It was the equivalent of, he used to text my Apple T to quickly go to a file. He implemented Quick Open in the editor in a day. Like, never touched it before, like, did all this stuff. And so it really showed us the power. If you give people what they need to get stuff done, they'll do it.
Right.
They want to do it, they want to get involved, and it's been, now he's been on the project the whole time. I believe he's still in high school, this guy. He's amazing. Yeah, all the contributors, we had syntax, engine stuff people have put in, someone ported it to Dojo, which was a huge effort. And we just like again and again seeing people come up and do amazing work. So we're jazzed.
So we got to wrap up, but he got 50 points. If you want 100 points, go to the site.
Exactly.
I'm not signing you up to give away free beers, but points. So thank
great
you so
dude.
Much, man.
Always a pleasure, my friend.
You too, my friend.
Yeah. Thank you.